Hello, my name is John Mount. I'm a principal for the data science consulting company, WinVector LLC. WinVector produces data science projects and solves data science problems for clients. We also train data scientists. I'd like to talk a bit on what data science is. At the 30,000 foot level, data science is the field that encompasses a number of skill sets and processes that have been around for a while. It includes data engineering, which is the collection and management of data, fields that traditionally include databases and larger structures like Hadoop. It includes predictive analytics, where tools like machine learning are used to make predictive models, or models that, given experiences from old data, can make predictions that are useful on new data. It also incorporates a number of tools and methods of business intelligence, the generation of reports, interviewing of clients to find true needs. Where it tends to differ a little from business intelligence is the degree of automation. Programming becomes required in data science so that the processes can be rerun without involving the analyst. And also, the analysis techniques tend to not only be traditional statistical methods such as regression, but machine learning techniques such as support vector machines and random forests. These all should be fairly indecipherable technical terms, but the idea is the data scientist is able to bring them in to perform useful business analysis. What I'd like to do is back up a bit and demystify what I've just said. I want to compare data science to something people are more familiar with, which is business analytics. To do that, I want to show how one of my favorite data science tools, a system called R, like the letter in the alphabet, compares. I'd like to show how R compares to a very common business analysis tool, Microsoft Excel. And what I'm going to show is a task that you wouldn't find too surprising in Excel, loading some data and performing a small analysis, is done very similarly in R. It's just where the Excel user interface is driven by menus and gestures. The R user interface is driven by typing. Well, actually programming, but for basic analysis, you don't actually need to write a program. You just need to type in what you want to happen, which I will show in the following demonstration. Let's work our fictitious example. I'm going to work the example first using Microsoft Excel. This is because Excel is going to be more familiar to more people, especially data analysts. I will then rework the example using R. Our fictitious example is I am collaborating with a friend on analyzing data that simulates a magazine that is assigning ratings to cars. I don't know how legible this email is at this size, so I'll read through it a bit. But my colleague has found a database from the UCI Machine Learning Archive that is a synthetic data set that simulates a consumer magazine that rating cars. The consumer magazine is taking measured features like car price, maintenance cost, fuel efficiency, and safety rating to build an overall purchase or do not purchase rating. And in our fictitious example, we're imagining that we may have access to these measured features of cars, and we'd like to predict the app magazine's overall purchase or non-purchase recommendation prior to the magazine coming out, perhaps for marketing reasons. And my colleague has actually saved the data out of the URL and attached it to this email, and we'll save that attachment so we can work with it. And they've also generously given us their instructions on how to start an analysis. And it looks like our colleague has investigated how much does the safety rating influence the magazine's overall purchase rating. And that's a very good idea, because we kind of figure for a consumer-style magazine, a safety measurement is going to really influence whether they recommend to purchase something or not. So they've confirmed this by analyzing the data, and they've given me instructions how to do this in Microsoft Excel. Because I'm not very good at Excel, they've actually laid out all the gestures and clicks required. Their first instruction is, I need to load the data, and when doing that, using File Open, I need to double check that all files is selected so that I can actually get at the file. So let's do that. File, Open, there's the data. And he's right, I can't select it. So I move from all readable documents to all files. Still gray, but I can select it.
and I've opened the data. The first row, and this may not be very legible, but I'll make it larger in a bit, is the header. And it says what's in each column. For instance, the D column is labeled persons, and it has numbers in it like 2 and 4 and more. So 2-seater cars, 4-seater cars, and larger vans. The last column is labeled rating, and it has strings in it like unacceptable and acceptable and some other values. So that's the column we're trying to predict as a function of the other columns. Under the usual machine learning assumption that we may be capable of measuring the buying cost, the maintenance cost, the number of doors, the number of seats, the size of the trunk or lug, and the safety rating. And then from that, we want to recover what is the overall purchase recommendation this magazine makes, or what is essentially the magazine's policy. And again, for our first study, our colleague has figured out that safety is a big factor in the rating, and we want to confirm that in the data. And how they've told us to do that is to build a pivot table. And they've given us detailed instructions. They first said to add an extra column to the table called car count and fill it with ones. So we'll go ahead and do that. Just type in the name car count, fill in a one, let it smart fill the rest of the column. Then they said the next step is to build the pivot table, which I'll do now. So we just select an arbitrary cell, select the data tab from that control, build a pivot table, throw away the pre-selected field controls, move safety into the row label control, move rating into the column label control. So we're now measuring the relationship between safety and overall purchase rating, and then move the car count into the sum of values control. I'm going to throw away the builder. And what we can see is this row, which is talking about cars with a low safety rating, has only cars in the unacceptable column. So no car with a low safety rating got anything other than unacceptable. And we see only cars with a high safety rating ever got a very good purchase recommendation. So it definitely looks like safety is driving a lot, but not all, of the purchasing decision. For instance, 204 cars with a high safety rating got a purchase recommendation of acceptable, and 180 got medium. And there's some more. There's also the good purchase recommendation column. And you can see basically safety is not controlling all of the decision. There's more factors. However, we can repeat this analysis in R. And this will let us see how the same steps are done in a different system. It's going to involve, just like in Excel, some use of controls and typing. So what I've done is prepared for my colleague a return email. And I've repeated their entire analysis in 3 lines of R. And then I've taken the analysis a little further. And I think even though these instructions might be a little hard to read and a little opaque, they're actually smaller than the instructions required for a non-experienced person to do the analysis in Excel. And they can be cut and pasted, which I think is kind of cool. So to do this analysis, I start up a copy of RStudio, and I'm just going to try pasting my first instruction into RStudio. What I've done is I've told RStudio that I would like a variable named cars, get it by reading a table, and I've used my colleague's URL to where to get the table. I didn't have to bother to save the data. I can now look at this data. There's 2 ways to do that in R. One looks a little like Excel. It's called View. And it shows me a tabular form of rows and columns of the data, which I can then scroll through. However, R also has a very useful function called summary, and I can say, give me the summary of cars. And it says things like, for buying, there are 4 values, high, low, medium, very high, and in this data set, there were exactly 432 cars that had a high cost, 432 had a low cost, 432 that had a medium cost, and 432 that had a very high cost. And the fact that these counts are so even is very suspicious. In fact, this comes from the fact that this is actually a synthetic data set that somebody made up to write about a specific machine learning paper or method that they liked. But let's go on and repeat the analysis. We're going to build the pivot table that they built. And it turns out that command is just called table in R. So we just say with the cars data, build the table relating safety to rating. And we don't have to add a ones column. And that gives us exactly the same table that came out in Excel. For instance, we see in this row, every car with a low rating had an unacceptable purchase rating or purchase advice. So we've confirmed by looking at this table how safety influences purchase rating. However, we can quickly do a lot more in R. I'm going to load a modeling and plotting package. Again, I've sent my colleagues these instructions. And I'm now going to ask R to build a model of the rating recommendation as a function of the measured facts about cars. So I say my model will be an R part model predicting rating as a function of buying cost, maintenance cost, number of doors, number of seats, size of lug or trunk, and safety rating. The data is the variable I've already called cars. And this is a bit obscure, but I'm saying please don't look at more than 6 things when you decide on cars. The model's been constructed. And then I can actually plot the model. And it's in this pane right here. It's a little too small to be legible. So I'm going to go back to my email and show the copy I sent my colleague. And what it is, it's something called a decision tree. And it says, take the car you're trying to rate and first look at, does it seat for persons? Did the car have 4 or more seats? If no, go to the right. And in the right thing, we say our decision is that car is unacceptable, and we also have these numbers, which I'll explain in a minute. And that's what I told my colleague. And also notice, if the car seats 4 or more people, we go to the left. So if it did not seat 4 or more people, we go to the right. If it seats 4 or more people, we go to the left. And it now then checks safety. If safety is high or medium, go to the left. If safety is low, not high or medium, go to the right. I follow the no branch, and you notice it now says the decision is unacceptable, and again we have 4 numbers. Those 4 numbers are given by there in that node. Every port of that diagram is called a node. Is there are 4 possible ratings or purchase ratings you give: acceptable, good, unacceptable, or very good. In the diagram, those numbers are what fraction of the cars we know about were in each category. So when we said 2-seater cars go down the right to no, it says our answer should be unacceptable. And in all the cars we've seen, 100% of them were in that category 3 or unacceptable. Same for cars that don't have high or medium safety. Later on in the tree, we get more confused nodes. Like here at the bottom left, a car that seats 4 or more people, has high or medium safety, low or medium buying cost, high or very high maintenance cost, and a large trunk is acceptable 83% of the time because, again, the first category was acceptable. Good 0% of the time, unacceptable 7% of the time, and very good 7% of the time. Reading off those numbers, 0.830, 0.07, 0.10 as percents. So this gives us a diagram we could actually print out on paper and use to rate cars, called a decision tree. And it also gives us an estimate of the quality of the model that basically most nodes were right about 80% of the time. Here's a node where we're only right about 60% of the time. And some of these nodes right all of the time. So at least on the training data, this model is really explaining a lot of the magazine's decision procedures. And it looks like really, you know, how many people it seats, the safety, and the purchase price, since those tend to be the earlier decisions in the tree, are driving a lot of these decisions. And that's what I sent back to my colleague. And I said, you know, maybe with some training, we could circulate the diagram to our representatives and they could make the prediction of themselves on paper. And I'm not really trying to call out the difference between the results we got in R and in Excel, but just maybe the similarities. Both of them require, if you don't know what you're doing, fairly long and detailed instructions. However, R is entirely text-based, so I could actually copy-paste those instructions line by line, or I could store them in an editor file and maybe edit them. Like even somebody that doesn't know how to program, they could maybe try to take lug boot out, like if they don't want trunk space to be part of the model, or they could maybe monkey with this max depth control, because that's kind of, you can kind of guess that's basically going to be how many lines are allowed in this diagram or tree, or how deep it's allowed to go. And we could try setting that to a smaller number, like two. So I just up arrow to get back to a command. I rebuild a new model with max depth 2, and then I replot the model. And I get here on the left, right, a much smaller tree that it says if you're only going to use two variables, use persons and safety, and if you do not seat four or more, if you seat four or more, go to the left. If you don't seat four or more, go to the right, and you're unacceptable. If your safety is high or medium, go to the left. If your safety is not high or medium, go to the right, and you're purely unacceptable. And then if you do go to the left, we know that 50% or 0.5 of the cars are the category one are acceptable, and the other 33% are unacceptable. So we don't really have a very good prediction on just two variables, but we do have for some fraction of the cars that basically we know this magazine does not accept small cars, two-seaters, or unsafe cars, many of which may be the same cars for all we know. But what I'm saying is that written instructions, unlike gestural instructions, can be copy-pasted. And basically, without programming, someone can try just to change a few numbers, rerun, and see what happens. And that is something I'm pretty excited about with R. And the second thing I'm very excited about with R is I can bring in modeling packages. In this case, I brought in R part to build something called decision trees and just apply it to data. I could just as easily brought in a more modern technique such as random forests or something exciting like support vector machines.
Now that you've seen R in use, you may be a little more interested in the history of R and what it is. R is the second or open source implementation of the S programming language. S was invented by John Chambers and became the core of the commercial analysis package S+. As we've mentioned, using R requires a bit more programming than Excel. To get more familiar with programming, we suggest Garrett Grohlman's Hands-On Programming with R. It works through basic exercises to familiarize the reader with basic programming tasks in R. For an overview of more of R and some of the statistical tools available in R, we recommend Jared Lander's R for Everyone. If you want to move on and do more work as a data scientist or with data scientists, we recommend Practical Data Science with R by Nina Zumel and myself. This book assumes you have some familiarity with R and statistics and works through what is the entire project life cycle of data science projects and what are the expectations of data scientists, how to scope and start projects, how to choose machine learning algorithms, how to choose between machine learning algorithms, and also how to deploy models into production and make final presentations to your important business partners. Thank you very much for your time.